Mini Chapter 21, Herb Hacks Evelyn's Code. At his desk in the Melrose Avenue building, a warm light glows somewhere behind Jamie's eyes at the sense of ease and freedom spreading out from between the ones and zeros of Evelyn's freshly emerged code in his text editor window. While he stares, though, it seems the subtlest change of flavour is occurring somewhere within her without his inputting any further edits. It's such a low-key change, he almost fails to register it, but it's true. He frowns, sits up straight. What's happening? His screen isn't big enough to display the whole windowful of Evelyn without needing to scroll, so he cannot take in all of her in one glance. But his eyes scan her code hard and fast. He can't quite put his finger on it, but something's changed in her. He can sense it. He's being hacked. Is he? Or is he just imagining things? To his horror, while he stares at the letters, figures and symbols and spaces that fill her window, an Ain't They Freaky logo and a small string of bang-dead code pop up deep inside the final section of her, trying to nestle unobserved in the middle of a dense paragraph. Jaymi yelps in pain and anger at this mutilation being wrought in the internal life of his new beast through the clumsy meddling of Bang-Dead Games' esteemed programmer. Launching himself forward and into damage control, he returns his work to an earlier restore point, quarantines his current session, creates appropriate backups, and sends these zinging into the cloud. He starts a full system scan. Then, while this purrs away, he sinks back and stares out at the distant fountains in the plaza, his mind racing. Whoever managed to break into this particular environment here has some serious chops as a hacker. And this very fact, in the context of the little text format logo that popped up in Evelyn's code like a cuckoo's egg, points Jaymi straight away towards someone specific, Herb Shrem. It must be. Oh, piss off, says Jaymi aloud. How beyond irritating to have his work invaded like this, and by a gormless shrub like Herb. Well, gormless in many ways, but pretty impressive on the hacking front. Accessing this newly emerged code was pretty hardcore in view of the security measures in place here. Aside from Herb himself, only Jaymi is in a position to know how hardcore it was to have circumvented them. And since Jaymi blocked this hack, Herb will also be surmising at perhaps this very moment that Jaymi has deduced both the skills level and the identity of his hacker. To construe this blocked hack as anything but the opening shot in a longer battle would be a construal requiring a degree of contrivance. Without a word being exchanged, each of these two programmers will therefore be thinking about the other right now to the exclusion of anyone else. A modern-day romance, to be sure. The system scan comes to an end. Jaymi opens the quarantined file and inspects Herb's intrusions. After a minute, he gives a snort, then a grudging nod. To be fair, Herb's contributions were not as malicious as he was fearing. The very best handful of them even seemed to be in tune with how Evelyn expresses something of Jaymi's lifelong awareness of the overall tendency for most women to be just a bit freer, subtler, more fun and more interesting than most men. But most of Herb's contributions are emotionally crass bits of whimsy, one or two of which are quite droll, Jaymi has to admit. For example, there's a moment in the game that she inhabits, the Imagination Thief, when the narrator spies into one of Evelyn's most private, imaginative landscapes without her knowing he is spying, a kind of enchanted coastline, as it happens, which she has always thought of as a mushroom bay. Jaymi's original code for this, before Herb came butting in today, had been impeccably respectful of his beast's private imagination. Addressing Evelyn as you, the Imagination Thief's narrator, had described this magical location of hers with the words, quote, "The only things growing on the curve of this enchanted shore are mushrooms, some a meter high. As you nod in solemn pride at this, a line of dolphins leaps from the water far across the bay, then dive beneath the surface once again without a ripple. We hear a magic interval between two notes several times, bewitching as if an angel lives between them. And I know that I should now leave your mushroom bay. I shan't intrude again here, so never shall I hear again that magic angel interval, but never will it leave me." Unquote. And what little extra has Herb added to this innocently enchanted landscape in Evelyn's imagination? A mere detail that many players might not have noticed, but no less outrageous a thing to have smuggled in. He has appended, quote, a clump of human penises of every colour of international flesh is planted in a wide flower pot on the shoreline of your mushroom bay, Evelyn, waving and twirling in expectancy. As soon as you approach them down the sand, they come to a stop one by one. As you approach, they turn to face you, as if sniffing the air, twitching in readiness. The nearer you approach them, the higher and more excitably they swell, until they are all thrashing and straining upwards at your passage along the beach beside them. Unquote. Jaymi laughs aloud, despite his mounting indignation. Herb has even nailed something of Jamie's own style in coding his beasts. His mirth soon dies down, though. Herb was a cheeky wag there, yes, but a little of that sort of stuff goes a hell of a long way in any context outside the tabloid-flavoured culture that Jaymi knows to be so prevalent in Dud's division of Bang Dead Games. And Herb's career has been steeped in that Dud culture, which will inevitably have tended to warp his cultural and creative instincts. Any further input from him would therefore tend to give Jaymi's code a small push towards the cruelty and tackiness of Ain't They Freaky. Combing her code, he locates many more of the tweaks Herb has made, scattered throughout its length. And yes, there's no getting away from the fact that Herb's overall contribution is designed, in effect, to subvert the code by dumbing it down towards a tabloid flavour, in ways that are aesthetically debased and imbued with a deep-seated mean-mindedness. For Jaymi, Evelyn has been taking shape as a happy, functional and self-possessed party girl, no saint, but innately rich and generous. Yet across the board, wreaking insidious violence on that shape, Herb has been all too predictable in warping those qualities into a soulless cartoon version of her, infused with brassiness, sleaziness, and simplicity, none of which are true to herself, and all of which serve to shortchange Herb's audience, cheapen Evelyn, and cheapen the world. A stab of tension and entrapment passes through Jaymi, as if this violence being done to his beast's essential nature extended even into his own torso, sitting out here in meat space in the Melrose Avenue building. As for Evelyn's own perceptions, Jaymi assumes that this hack into his beast's code must surely have been felt as a kind of existential violence. So she will have suffered too when the cheapness started flowing into her. Fortunately, however, she will not have to retain any memory of that suffering. By running comparisons of successive versions of her code, taken from the automated backups generated since the restore point he chose, he should now be able to identify exactly when Herb's first change was made to her, then delete all his meddlings and consign them to the category of alternate life histories that never happened, so she will never know what her digital genetic fate might have been. And this is just what he spends the next couple of hours doing, with the greatest of care and eventual success. At last, his beautiful beast is back to how she was meant to be at this tender stage of her creation cycle. But if Bang Dead wants a battle, then by God they've got one. Never again will he let himself be hacked. His hands clasp his upper arms across his chest as if in protection of her.